we are.
Welcome to What's New. And tonight we have two gentlemen with us. Aris, do you want to go and introduce them?
Okay. We have David Wood from St. Mary's and Robert Fox from Lake Forest. Mm-hmm. And they're going to give us a lot of information about the CERT program. Bob represents the health department, and David represents St. Mary's. And
yeah, and I'm also in the health department.
Oh, you're in the health department also. Okay. So whichever one wants to start talking, go right ahead.
I'll go ahead and start. CERT stands for Community Emergency Response Team. This was started after a 2011, I think, a presidential directive. What it does is it teaches people how to survive after a natural or man-made disaster. And when you live along an earthquake fault in Tornado Alley next to a river, disasters are going to happen. So the more training you can have, the better prepared, you know, you're going to be to survive it yourself, help your family survive. And then the next mission we hope is that people will go out and help their community survive. And it's broken up into, you know, different categories. Some of the curriculum, there's modules for disaster preparedness, fire safety, medical operations 1 and 2, search and rescue, CERT organization, disaster psychology, terrorism, and then there's a disaster exercise at the end where you actually, you know, learn techniques for how to move people, how to, you know, how to actually work in a disaster area.
Well, you got quite a list of training then. Oh, are these signed up for separate classes then, or are they?
It's one long class. We've got this scheduled for Tuesdays starting on January 19th. From 6 p.m. until 9 p.m. That's located at the St. Genevieve County Health Department in our basement area along the backside. And their number is 883-7411 for anybody that would like to sign up. And we do encourage that.
Yeah. This program is funded nationwide down from FEMA down through Office of Homeland Security and out through the states, and it's through the state of Missouri in our case that a lot of these monies come down and are distributed primarily to health departments, but there are some other agencies that do CERT training, some probably in some counties of the emergency management.
I have to laugh. Look at the screen. We're having lightning strikes.
Disaster's coming right now.
Yeah, we have a disaster now. That's
okay,
all right. We
sorry.
Can handle it.
Yeah, I got my pack.
Sorry.
I'm working.
Yeah. So this is not just a local phenomenon. It's something that's nationwide, and it's encouraged in some communities. It's very popular. A lot of people partake of the training. Other communities not. It just depends on the, I guess, the philosophy and the psychology of the community. But it's extremely important that at least this is offered, because the training is excellent. It's rudimentary in that we don't go into any great depth with things like the medical training or the search and rescue, but it is enough to where should something happen in your community, in your neighborhood, you would be able to perform reasonably well within the confines of your training. So it's, in our opinion, is well worth doing. We've expanded that. It's been expanded with the latest revision of the training. The new manuals that are out now are a lot bigger than what Dave and I went through. And what's cool, what's really nice about our community is that we get people from outside the health department, in this particular case, to help with the training. For example, with the medical training, the ambulance district will provide one of their paramedics to come over and talk about, you know, the aspects of first aid or CPR if that should be necessary. There's a whole gamut of subject matter within one particular module of the training. But the other thing is, when we get to the point where we talk about, for example, electricity,
Chip Marzuko
will participate and actually bring a whole box of various circuits and all kinds of things, and he really gets into it. It's really kind of fun to watch him and discuss the ins and outs of electricity. So it's a very good program. We're trying to encourage people to take it. We think it's extremely important, and that at least a small segment of our county is trained in this type of thing. Just like what's happened in the last 6 months now, we've had two large rain events where, you know, we've had more water than we
wanted.
So, but it's from that standpoint, it's an excellent program.
Do they do the first aid training? I mean, is that part of it?
It's rudimentary. It's not certified first aid training, but yes, we do talk about some first aid, how to perhaps bandage a person that might have a cut on their arm or something like that. It doesn't go beyond that, because to do that we have spent more time doing that.
In other words, this kind of gives you the basic of all the elements in your house, like your electric and water, and if something like a fire or tornado or anything like that, it gives you all the aspects, basics of what to do.
We do cover how to shut off your different utilities, your gas, your electric, your water, because, you know, you can't have, you know, water mixing with electricity, and you know, can't have a water heater going without water in it. So that way you can keep your home safe. And I want to elaborate on some of the instructors. We have excellent instructors teach this class. I mean, we're both certified, but we bring in experts. Somebody from the hospital will come in and do the disaster psychology segment. Usually somebody from the fire department will come do the fire safety, which is also how to suppress fires. You know, there will be a fire pan and there will be a fire, and you will be, you know, shown how to put out a fire with a live fire extinguisher and go out and learn how to do it, you know, just like the firefighters do. You know, now we don't encourage people to go fight big fires. You know, there are two expressions that you will hear throughout the class a lot. One of them is safety first. You know, do not make yourself a victim, you know, trying to do something that is too dangerous. And the other expression is doing the most good for the most people. In a major traumatic event, you know, you're not going to be able to help everybody, you know, but use your resources wisely and help as many people as possible, you know, to help survive such a thing.
I'll be darned. And this is the 19th of January?
It starts January 19th at 6 and 9 p.m. and continues every Tuesday for five Tuesdays. There's five class dates total.
And then are you going to repeat the program?
We've had this program going, and the health department's had this going for four or five, maybe longer than that.
I remember hearing about it.
We probably will try to have, now this is a night class. We probably will try to have at least one day class, probably in the summer. Mm-hmm. So we try to get at least two classes in a year. And on the day classes, sometimes we're a little more successful with the night classes, because some people who do partake of that are still working, so they can go at night. But so the day classes, sometimes we don't get as many participants as we would like. However, we encourage organizations, businesses who perhaps might think that some of their employees might benefit from this, and in turn, of course, the company would benefit, to encourage maybe sending a couple of employees along and have them train in this type of emergency response. So, very good program. Very good program. But we've had over 100 people go through it in the last couple of years, haven't we?
And the more the better. In an emergency, we want everybody to help out, because if there is a giant traumatic event, there's only so many police officers, so many firefighters, so many ambulances to help, you know, cover their entire jurisdiction, you know, and that's why it's important for the community to step up and try to help each other, you know, and be prepared in those
Now, how many of these classes do you have to go to? Just one? Or to all of them?
Well, all of the ones that you see on their list, you have to go to all of those. The program itself is 24 hours in length.
So
you have to complete the 24 hours, but several hours of that at the end is the scenario where we try to, as best we can, create a search and rescue environment where you have to put into practice what you've learned, including how to properly lift injured patients and transport them and so on, and set up a rudimentary triage and be able to address certain types of wounds and so on.
And we have very good victims.
Yeah.
the
we have some
health
people
department.
Who love to be victims. Yeah, that works out quite well, really.
Mm-hmm. It really does.
Yeah.
And a lot of counties, you know, when you take a CERT class, you know, you don't get any, you know, any supplies or equipment, you know, but however, St. Genevieve County does provide those.
Yeah.
We do teach, well, not us, but the CERT classes are also taught in both high schools.
That's what I was just going to ask,
so,
if the high school kids.
Teach them when they're young, you know. And some of the things you'll get, I don't know how much since the flood in June that we've replaced, but, you know, typically we'd like to give a backpack, you know, to each participant. A helmet, you know, that way you can, you know, be safe. you get, you know, eye protection, you know, in case there's, you know, anything, you know, flashing about. The N95 mask, you know, which for dust, this keeps 95% of the dust, you know.
I wear them in my basement.
For you breathing in. you also get a vest, you know, very, very reflective material.
Ooh.
On this, you know, plus it identifies yourself as a CERT team member. That way the community can kind of know, you know, that you've had, you know, some official training, and it kind of puts them at ease that you're actually there to help them, not loot them, or, you know, whatever the case may be. So, and then after that, there's a pair of gloves, and you'll probably get some bandages and things like that. And then we encourage people to also add to your pack. You know, I've got a first aid book in here. I've got markers so I can mark up. We also teach how to mark a building so that you can put what date you searched it, you know, what CERT team you are and what the results were. So it's a very, very informative and very good class.
Now, when you search the building, that's searching for people? Or?
Yes.
People, pets, you know, and anything that might be within the confines of the building that, you know, if we can get them out, we try to get them out.
Mm-hmm.
But again, as David said, it's safety first. So you would like, you put yourself in a position where you're trying to help someone, but you have to remember that. And in the case of either a tornado or an earthquake or a windstorm or something where there's a damaged structure, there might be a situation where even though you know someone might be in there or someone's pet that is in need of rescue, if you deem it unsafe, what you do is you kind of stand back and try to get other first responders there to help do that might have the proper equipment. And David's got his bag here, with my bag, I've sort of augmented mine with other types of things. I have an LED flashlight that is a lot brighter than what comes with the bag. Plus the LEDs now, the modern LEDs last longer and take less energy with just using just AA batteries. Yeah. In my case, I've also bought a something that is sort of a multi-use light that can be used as either a directional type of thing, or it can be, you can you know, use it for this, for sort of signaling or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But that's something that I purchased myself, and I'm not saying you have to do that. The gloves that come with the bag are usually gloves that you can normally pick up at a Home Depot or a Lowe's or the True Value Hardware store in town here, which is an excellent place.
They're real good leather work gloves.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And in my case, what I've done is augmented those with a pair of gloves that you would normally find with firefighters when they're doing extrication with taking people out of cars that have been messed up in an automobile accident. These are extrication gloves where they're padded such that they protect the backs of your hands and your knuckles as you're working, but they're also have a certain type of material on the palm that keeps it from being cut. So if you're dealing with broken glass or jagged metal or anything like that, you protect your hands a lot better. So that's just again personal preference. You don't have to do that. I did that on my own, but that's certainly some of the things you can think about. If you get involved in this program and you really take it seriously, like David and I do, sometimes you think you might add a few extra tools.
Yeah.
To the bag.
And you mentioned extrication. Another thing you learn in the class is what's called cribbing, where if somebody's trapped under a heavy object, how you can use, like, you know, other objects around the house, you know, two befores, you know, rocks, books, whatever, so that you can help try to lift them and get them out from underneath that heavy object. Hazmat is also taught in this class. You can identify the different placards to see if, you know, is it, like, how exactly dangerous is this material, you know? And I don't know if we give the books or not.
I don't know whether we do or not,
okay,
in the class.
But we do teach how to read, you know, the different placards and what they mean, you know, so that way, you know, you can identify that and know, okay, we need to get back from this, or this is not as bad as, you know, some others. So you do walk away from this class with a lot of knowledge. You really do. That's why we strongly encourage it, you know.
Yeah, the class has gone through an evolution. When I took mine about 4 years ago, it did not contain a lot of the material that's in it now. So I think the people at the Office of Homeland Security have really tried to make an impact on this program by making it stronger and including more material and everything else. But the really nice thing about a program is that at the end of it, again, we go through this scenario where you'd be surprised how people, you know, really get into it. Because one of the things you have to do is when you arrive on scene is you have to decide who's going to be your leader, because you always have to have some sort of leader. So somebody either volunteers or you get volunteered, one of the two, and then you go through there. In that particular scenario, when you go through that, we as instructors will make notes, and at the end we'll have a little grading process where we talk about the things you did really good, and then we'll talk about the things you really didn't think about when you were doing them, but that you should think about, because the way you did them in real life, it might have worked out differently than what it did in the little play exercise that we do. But that's always the most fun part of the training.
It's very realistic. It really is. Yeah. I mean, it's usually dark. I don't want to give away all the things that are going to happen, but no. it's like the
we
real
try to
thing.
Make it as realistic as we can within the scope of the exercise.
Yeah, and when we teach this, you know, because whenever you're in an exercise, there might be a lot of people screaming, you know, but something we teach in the class: if somebody's screaming, well, you know they're getting oxygen, so you might want to deal with somebody who might need, you know, CPR, you know, ahead of them, you know. So that's why we stress the most good for the most people, you know, just because they're screaming don't mean you go to that person first, you know, try to help out, you know. We usually you'll do a search pattern throughout the structure.
So each one of these classes is a different element.
Oh yeah, they're broken down into different modules, and we've added a lot. A lot, like you mentioned, because there is a minimum curriculum that we have to cover, but then we expand upon that. Like the electrical safety, you know, that's not part of the original, the official curriculum. We added that because we felt it was very, very important. And Jim Arnuto does an excellent job.
Normally, an average person doesn't know what to do about their electricity in storms or things like that. I wouldn't know what to do except pull the main switch and hope it turns everything off.
And how to hook up a generator correctly. If you hook up a generator incorrectly, you just might blow out a lot of, you know, electrical in your house. And plus, transformers are made to send electricity, not to receive it. So you may blow your transformer and knock out your whole neighborhood. So electrical safety is a very, very important subject.
So you have to be kind of healthy to do this, son.
Well,
not necessarily.
Right. I mean, you'd have to be healthy if you're going to carry people, you know, out of a scene. But I mean, as far as providing first aid to somebody, or, you know, and those are helping with disaster psychology, helping calm somebody down and what to say and what not to say to people, you know, you can always use those skills no matter what your physical attributes are.
So in other words, elderly people can participate in this, okay?
Yes, they can. And we do not expect anybody to do anything beyond their ability. It's safety first, you know, with this class.
One of the things we stress is that there's always the chance that you might be the first person on the scene, you and maybe your group of responders. So we teach you, you know, that as a responder in your case, You have certain responsibilities and so on, but you're not necessarily the same as a firefighter or as a member of an ambulance crew. So you know, there are some constraints there. And what we train you to do is to do some things in a small way, such that you can perhaps stabilize the incident in hopes of that the other responders, be it law enforcement, be it fire, be it EMS, are going to arrive relatively soon. When that happens, then you take a step back and let them take it from there. So really our goal is really, if we're on the scene first, is to stabilize the situation. If nothing else, gather information such that you can relay it to the people, the other responders, when they do show up.
I can see where this would really be important if there was a tornado.
Oh yeah.
Because yeah, with so few, yeah, they couldn't be everywhere.
No. No,
I mean,
and that's a good point. Mm-hmm. And that usually is what happens, is even though we have 7 fire departments in our county, which do a really good job of covering their particular portion of the county. You know, if we have a widespread event like a tornado whose path is perhaps 6 or 7 miles long, the Joplin tornado, I think that had a path of close to 9 or so miles, I think, in length. Not to mention the fact that at the height of the storm, the tornado was right at about a mile wide, so it did a lot of damage. Well, your fire departments are going to be stretched to the nth degree, as are your ambulance crews and as well as law enforcement. So a program like this really can make ready a number of people that could really perform a very important function in that particular instance. Mm-hmm. So,
well, the Joplin tornado destroyed a hospital and a school.
Yeah.
I mean, literally destroyed the hospital.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that would be, that would be horrible.
Well, plus, besides the limited resources, access, you know, if there's an earthquake and it knocks out, you know, most of the bridges, you know, Amazon, the fire department's not going to get to you.
Right.
You know, so we do teach, you know, I think it's probably the first day on disaster preparedness. You know, you need to be able to shelter in place and survive for 3 days. So you need to have water, canned goods. I mean, you need to, you know, kind of, we have like a checklist, you know, for things that people should have on hand and think about. You know, make sure the batteries for your flashlight are good. You know, make sure your pets and your kids are also have supplies. You know, because people, you know, besides teaching you how to do this, you know, 60% of people will not evacuate their home if they cannot take their pet with them. So, you know, that's why, you know, you need to keep your kids happy and your pets happy and keep the stress level down. And disaster psychology covers kind of some of that we cover as well.
Mm-hmm. In addition to the modules that we've already talked about, the other things we do cover and that I, in most cases, will teach, there's two modules that I sort of specialize in. And one is incident command. Again, from the top, from FEMA through Office of Homeland Security and so on, a number of years ago, they came up with a command system that they're trying to get everybody within the country to sort of standardize on. Primarily because if an event is extremely significant, meaning it's large, and you have the coming together of multiple agencies, if everybody understands this one command system called the incident command system, then the working together of those agencies becomes, of course, a lot easier and a lot more smooth. And so one of the things I do is I teach the incident command system, what it is, why we have it, how it works, its ability to expand and contract with the incident itself. If an incident's small, you don't have to use all of it, you can use a portion of it. If that incident is larger or expands, then you can bring into play other aspects of the command system. But really what they're wanting to do is get everybody on the same page around the country, so that if we have something relatively catastrophic and we have a coming together of multiple agencies, that we kind of all operate the same way. So they're all of a sudden you're a lot more productive, you know, by the time you put your feet on the ground, as opposed to taking some time to try to figure out who's going to be in charge and who's going to do this and who's responsible for that and so on. So, and there are various classes that expand upon that that you can take through the State Emergency Management Agency, and here in the state of Missouri offer classes around the state all the time, all the time. The other thing that in this day and age that is sometimes on the news virtually all the time and on people's lips probably not near as much, but is terrorism. So we do teach a module on terrorism. It's just a gloss over of the types of terrorism that there is, and that at a lot of times a terrorist might not necessarily be somebody that we think of as being Middle Eastern, which is sort of the default right now. But there are a lot of people who are born and raised in the United States who are disgruntled with a number of things, one of which might be the government or the local law enforcement or the local fire department, whatever, local government agency, and can become a homegrown terrorist. And that has happened, of course, on a grand scale in a number of situations around the country. The elementary school shooting up in Connecticut, Sandy Hook. And just recently, in Paris, France, the shootings there that in several parts of the city, you know, where armed gunmen were shooting up the place. So that's one of the things we talk about too. Even in the high school program, which I've taught in the high school programs too, we teach these types of classes. There's a little variation of them with some of the material, but both Valley and St. Jen received this training, and we talk about basically the same things. We talk about incident command, we talk about terrorism, and the whole gamut. And of course, they also get to partake in this scenario at the end, which is always fun.
Yeah, because you don't know, an ordinary person, you don't really know what they're thinking. I mean, they look ordinary, but they're not.
Well, right, and like you said, they're not all Middle Eastern, they're not all Muslims.
No.
Take Oklahoma City, for example. I mean, you know, just normal looking white Americans, you know, and look at the damage and the death toll. So, yeah, and, you know, if you see something, say something is, you know, you'll learn in that class too, and kind of how to identify the different types of weapons that they may use, be it chemical, biological, or nuclear, you know. So just to kind of be aware, you know, of your surroundings.
Sitting here thinking while you're talking, that if there was a disaster, that would really be a disaster.
Yes.
Because there's not, as we don't have a lot of policemen, ambulance.
I know it.
We don't have a lot of people that are trained, so this training is probably
really
great to have lot of people do it.
Yes, and there's only two buildings in this entire county that are set up to become shelters, and they're very limited. I mean, maybe 100, 150 in each one. You know, if we're talking about a county of 14,000 people or whatever we have. So there will be a need for people to shelter in place, and we're going to teach you how to do that.
What two buildings are?
One's the American Legion Hall, and I don't know what the other one is. Felix would know. Red Cross has it set up.
At one time, I think they had talked to the people at the First Baptist Church across from the health department there. I don't know what. We need to reinvestigate that, but they have some room there. There's a number of places around town, but primarily we have the American Legion, and I've often thought we could use the community center. You have basketball courts, you know. If we really had something disastrous, I mean, there's a number of places we can use, but
and probably people would open them up. Available space.
Yeah, we usually try to discuss those prior to any event with the people. American Legion's always been really good about making themselves available. And but the other thing with a disaster too, and I've taken a number of classes on animal sheltering in a disaster. We as a health department should a disaster happen, and we did have to shelter some people in a perhaps the American Legion, One of the things we do have to do in a small way is, if they have a pet, we have to provide for their pet as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we have some variances on how we can do that. I mean, it's depending on what the pet is, and also whether that pet plays well with the other pets in the shelter. But we are under some obligation to take care of a person's pet up to a certain point, and we have we can do that with a small number. But if we have something where, you know, we have a lot of people displaced, that might become a real problem. But
I think because almost everybody has a dog.
Yes.
I don't either.
I have my chubs.
She's got a dog.
Yeah. And cats.
Yeah. Yeah. And so cats could probably survive better than dogs.
Yeah. Yeah. But there's a lot of things to think about, and
there is, my goodness.
You know, if we have a team of people like this would be extremely important is that sometimes in a catastrophe you might lose the ability to contact other people. We're so used to in this day and age,
yes. Mm-hmm.
Picking up this thing and cell phone and then either texting or calling and if we have a tornado of some significance, you know, you could lose a whole bunch of cell towers to where this might not be worth much of anything for a while, and so this might not always be at your beck and call. So if that's the case and you can't communicate out to either 911 or any other people that you might consider as someone who might provide you some assistance, then you're on your own. And that's one of the things we emphasize with this program is that you have to make the assumption, depending on the event, that you might be on your own for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering about too, because if you wouldn't be able to call anybody.
Yeah.
And if there's no electricity, you're not going to be able to charge your
phone. And you won't be able to charge it. You know? So, in the Joplin tornado, in the path of the tornado, they lost all the cell towers there. Yeah, even though they lost a lot of them, evidently with somehow or another, I'm not an expert on this kind of communications, but even though you don't have voice communication, evidently there is the ability to still get a text out.
That's
texting is not necessarily disadvantaged in a catastrophe, but it may be. Again, if you lose cell towers in a large swath, I mean, it could be.
You probably don't need as strong a signal for a text message as you do for voice.
Yeah, yeah.
Probably.
But there's the things you have to consider, you know, but then what do you do? But if you have this type of training, then at least you have something you can fall back on and get your little group of people together. And even if you just take care of your neighbors, if you just go around for, in 360 degrees, just go one block. You know, if you live here in town, go one block, and just worry about that. And if that's all you can do, well, that's all you can do. Mm-hmm. But at least you can do that, because there's always somebody out there that might be in need of some assistance, in some form or fashion. So that's why we're really kind of pushing this program. The federal government has done we sometimes complain about our government that some of these programs and the training classes that I've taken are excellent, or that I've taken through the state, and a lot of them are federal classes that are offered by FEMA through University of Missouri's Extension. They're really quite good.
Another thing is a car.
You know,
if the roads are messed up, you can't drive anywhere.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Your garage falls on you. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah. And
there's really a lot to think about.
Yeah. And if nothing else, if you go out and you don't end up doing a lot of either search and rescue or using your first aid or anything like that, a lot of times what you can do is you can do a lot of documentation. Because what we're finding out now, both David and I, is that after an event happens, and hopefully you are going to expect maybe the federal government to reimburse you some money in disaster relief, well, they just don't walk up with the checkbook and write you a check, say, well, what do you need? And I mean, that you have to provide them with an exorbitant amount of documentation. So one of the things that a team like this can do in that event maybe is write down times, who was there, when were they there, what did they do, what resources did they have, what tools did they bring, what tools did they need, and so on. And that's, and you can tell your experiences just with the past week.
Yeah, the emergency's not over. we are in recovery phase, but that afterwards, the damage assessments, and I'm keeping every, I've got hundreds of pictures, which is very valuable. Every receipt, we've had sign-in sheets for everybody that came and helped sandbag, or at least as many as we could get to sign in, because FEMA looks at all that. You know, I mean, like you said, they just don't write a check. You know, I'm putting together an after-action report, and it's quite intense and quite lengthy. So somebody, even if your phone doesn't work as a text or voice, things got a camera on it.
Yeah,
go take pictures of some damaged houses, you know, which may come in handy when, you know, when they come
they
around.
They require a huge amount of documentation.
Yes.
A huge amount of documentation. Then it takes them forever to actually, if they decide to give you some money, it takes them forever to do that.
Yeah.
Well, they got a mess to work with now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, 155 and down here and along the river.
Well, the health department got flooded in June, you know, and we qualified for an emergency, you know, on a state and federal level. FEMA had meetings with the health department, and we still haven't got a check yet. So
yeah.
It takes months, maybe even a year, the way it's going.
Okay.
So
yeah.
Before any assistance comes, and it doesn't pay for everything. They'll only reimburse 85%, and they don't pay for everything. They're going to take a look at what, you know, was spent and say, okay, we'll cover this, we won't cover this. And so, yeah, recovery is a long process.
So you got a lot of recovery down in St. Mary's.
We had 22 buildings that were affected by the flood. And with this flood, we did not have very long to prepare.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, I was informed of the prediction on Sunday night, and it peaked Thursday night into Friday. So, and we called in everybody we could. I mean, many volunteers, but I mean, we were lucky because we had the Coast Guard there, the National Guard there, the Highway Patrol there with their boats. I mean, American Red Cross was delivering food. I mean, but in a real major disaster, you might not have anybody that can help you. So that's why we suggest, disaster preparedness, you know.
Now's a good time to have it because we're not out of the woods yet with the river.
No.
Not with all that that's up north and all the rains that are coming.
And have some kind of plan of action, you know, have some kind of contact. You know, we stress that, you know, have a contact that's out of state, you know, that way, you know, maybe you can't get a hold of somebody, you know, locally, but, you know, you can all call somebody and say, Ohio, and say, okay, if so-and-so calls, tell them I'm here. And that way you can communicate, you know, and have everybody's phone numbers, have prescriptions, you know, I mean, all that information is very helpful.
It sounds like a great program. If anybody has any questions, we have a telephone number.
Oh.
These guys are here. Call
7675, right?
Right.
It should be across the screen.
Yeah, it's 7675.
Because these guys are here and they could help you. Got any questions since we've been under the water?
Well, with David and I, this is, even though it's been a pain to deal with, it's been good in that this is a real situation wherein you have to start putting a lot of the stuff that you learn in these classes that you take, put into practice. And you can't, even though the classes are good, there's a lot of stuff you learn by, you know, the hard way. You know, when FEMA came down, we went with FEMA for the first time after the situation in June, with not only just the health department, but other places around the community that got flooded out. You know, that's, I tried to attend all the meetings I could, because that's where you learn what are they looking for? What do they want? What is, you know, and what kind of questions do they ask? And I'm always a little leery of am I at a point in my training and in my experience that I can properly address what it is the feds may want, because they're the ones that in the end are going to either award or not award us a reimbursement for the damage that we've had. So, you know, it's a learning process. So if we both David and I learn how to do this now, should there be something of greater magnitude in the future, perhaps a flood that's many times greater than this, or we have the earthquake that we all think's never going to happen,
yeah.
or we have a tornado. And you know, more than likely in the Midwest, we run the risk of a tornado more than certainly an earthquake. And with an earthquake, it's sort of hard to plan for those anyway.
Yeah,
they're so catastrophic that you know, you can have a plan, but you know.
Depends where
Mother Nature does what she wants to do.
That's for sure.
You know, but a tornado, because it's local, or it affects such a small
street.
Path or a small area, even though it's devastating, it's at least that makes it a little easier to deal with. But an earthquake would be tough. But this is we David and I are cutting our teeth on this, both of us.
Oh yeah, this was my first disaster. Yeah. I made a lot of did a lot of things right, but I did a lot of things wrong. So,
but you
are learning.
We're learning.
Yeah.
But at least you have enough time.
To do everything right.
You know, you have enough time to do this. But again, if we had, in both situations, particularly David's this last week, if we would have had more people who have had this type of training, there's so many things you can do besides get your hands dirty, get your clothes dirty, again, gathering information, taking photographs. There's a lot of things that you can do that would benefit the community.
Yeah. Did the high school kids come out and help?
We had four different high school teams come out.
Isn't
and help
that wonderful?
Yeah.
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 Oh, that's
some from
great.
The football team, boys basketball, girls basketball, and a wrestling team all came out to help. So that was wonderful.
That is great.
Great community support for them.
It's great.
Mm, now, yeah. Your backpack there, do you have to buy those things?
No. The health department, through grant money, normally provides the backpack, the gloves, the goggles, the mask, vest, and the helmet.
You used to have a little wrench in there.
There's a wrench also for
crescent
shutting
wrench
off.
For
yeah, shutting off the
gas,
water and,
yeah,
and the gas.
Yeah.
And then they'll usually, during the exercise, you can snag a pair of gloves.
So you furnish everybody with something like that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah, we've been lucky in that the health department has been, year after year, been able to get grant monies, usually from FEMA that we...
I believe it is.
Yeah, through FEMA that covers the cost of the pack. So the packs are free to all those who sign up for the class.
Oh.
So that's not a problem.
Mm-hmm.
We also can get monies through an organization called the Regional Homeland Security Oversight Committee for Region C. All regions have them in the state. We're in Region C, so I just attended a meeting yesterday where we talked about dollars being allocated to the various counties for CERT training and so on, which includes that mainly. So, and the booklets, because you get a pretty good sized book when you take the class.
Yeah.
And so you get that as well. So it's there's a little bit of money to get sunk into a per student cost.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why if it's free, all you have to do is invest your time and your interest.
Mm-hmm.
And for some people it's okay, and some they have to run out and find those somewhere.
Mm. Well, I'd be interested living by myself. Yeah. I'd be interested in to know what to do. Because basically,
you would find it interesting. I think you'd find it quite enjoyable,
yeah,
really.
Yeah, I think I would.
So that mean we can sign you up?
Yeah.
Call the health department, sign
up.
Yeah,
it's 883.
What is that number?
883-7411 is the health department's number, and they can take your.
Now, you don't really see this advertised too much.
No.
We advertise it in the St. John Herald. It's I forget what page it's on. It's the
community.
Yeah, it's.
Oh, the community.
Yeah
and it's a little paragraphs about various other events going on within the city and the county. So we always have something in there. We also do CPR classes, which we encourage people to do.
I just seen that on the billboard out here, CPR classes.
Yeah.
And usually, and first aid comes around too.
First aid, yeah. So Very good. The CPR first aid is sponsored by the American Heart Association, and we have a number of instructors at the health department, Mary Roth, Diane Giesler, Jenny Mueller, myself, will teach CPR first aid classes. And Mary Roth is our sort of leader on the CERT initiative, and is an excellent instructor.
She is.
Yeah, she's really, really good. Yeah. And she does an excellent job of sort of coordinating the final exercise, the little scenario at the end, mm-hmm. in getting it all put together and so on. So it's always a fun day at the end.
This would be something for neighborhoods to have a couple people do.
Yes, we encourage that. I mean, if you're in the
See if I get Geneva to go with me.
Yeah, she might.
I mean, yeah. I'd like to participate in that. Because I don't think you're never too old to learn anything new.
Yeah, and we also promote this on the health department's website and on their Facebook. So we encourage people to, you know, like us on Facebook.
So if we find it on Facebook and start sharing it, it'll
Yes, it will. Yeah. Yes, it will. We would like that.
Is there a page, or is it on the health department's website?
I know it's on the website.
Yeah.
There's a little explanation of what the class is and so on, and mm-hmm. tell you who to call to sign up. I'm sure it's on the Facebook page, because I look at their Facebook page every day, and I'm sure it's out there. But again, with the same information. So encouraging you to call and sign up, so we know how many people are coming. But
I thought if we would start sharing it, you know, with our friends and tell them to share
sure.
it.
Yeah.
And even mention that, it would be good for neighborhoods.
The CERT program actually works probably at its best in a neighborhood setting. Mm-hmm. So a lot of times when we discuss this, and maybe you can explain that too, that it's not necessarily widespread, but it's fully functional in just a small setting.
Right. Well, in congested, I don't want to say congested, but you know, in a city type area where you've got, you know, several, you know, your neighbors are relatively close, you know, this is a great, you know, class to have and great information. You know, if you live out in the boonies and your nearest neighbor's 2 miles down the road, you know, you might not be able to implement everything, but you can still take a lot of knowledge from this, you know, on you know, what you can do to help yourself survive the disaster. Mm-hmm. That's step one, surviving yourself. I mean, you know, you're not going to help anybody if you're a victim, so you know, everybody can benefit, but it does work good when you can get like a group of a small CERT team and just go block to block, mm-hmm. you know, checking on everybody, making sure they're okay. And you know,
I'm trying to set one up for Lake Forest, and I started about 3 months ago by just sending out some information about who would be interested in doing this. It took me a while to get a few people to come around, but I've got now a little nucleus of about 8 people that and I think 2 of them have signed up for the CERT class starting next week. But I have others who have already taken CERT training, who have already taken CPR and first aid training. So I've got already a start, a little covey of people that I can depend on. And one of the things we have been talking about is supposedly the weather forecast for example, the month of February. We're not quite sure what that's going to be yet, but it may prove, usually February can be a little bit on the nasty side. Snow is one thing, but if we have an ice storm, that of course means a lot of other things could happen. Mm-hmm. And so what I'm trying to do is get some people to be willing to go out if we have such a thing, and we're, you know, check on neighbors to see if they have power, or if they have, you know, the ability to get out, or do they need groceries, or does somebody need some medicine refilled, or you know, or do they need to contact somebody and they have no ability to do that, just to get out and just, you know, just go 3 or 4 houses in either direction, just kind of check. Mm-hmm. You know, if we have a windstorm, we have trees go down, or you know, and you could lose power, and in this time of the year, losing power could be significant for some people if you have an all-electric home, so mm-hmm. and you're without power for anywhere from 8 to 10 to 12 to 24 hours, so.
Yes, it's amazing how you depend on electricity.
Oh, yes.
And water and.
I remember in the 93 flood, water.
Water.
Oh, my gosh, yeah.
That was horrible.
It was. Everybody was going to MFA for water, filling jugs.
Oh, really?
Wow.
And the swimming pool became a shower station.
Oh, cool.
They drained the pool and they, you took showers in.
Wow.
With the pool water.
Okay.
And, let's see, where, there was another place that was, you could go to shower. I don't remember where that was at, though.
I'm trying to think.
And we live out of town and we could not come into town straight. We had to drive all the way around the highway.
And we had to move from in town. We moved over to St. Jude. St. Jude got flooded and then the water issue. Then we had to move all the way out to Weingarten to our son. Oh, that was almost horrible. And here I am working at City Hall and I can't go anywhere.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh,
yeah, that was Lord. That was a mess. It was.
It was horrible.
I think the water issue was probably one.
Yeah.
In addition to the water being so deep, was.
Yeah, because I have water up here on Market Street, that little creek back there.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I had water down that lower lot, which I don't have that lower lot now, but I had water down there.
Yeah.
And that was the 93.
And that was a long-term event.
Yes, it was.
It lasted a long
time. Oh,
yes. Some events don't last as long, can be devastating, but perhaps short-lived. But and again, the importance of considering a program like this, where you can organize a group of people with similar training and provide a lot of good to the community.
They had that. That was pretty well organized, I think. That
yeah.
They, the Vets Hall and the Legion Hall, both had food. The pool was showers. It seems like there was someplace else that was showers.
So Legion Hall, we had people in there.
The MFA had
water.
Water for everyone. I mean, you just went out there and filled your jugs and took it home, and that's what you drank. Or you bathe with, or depending on how much water you wanted to take. I mean, they ask you to conserve, but but it was county water, so it was. I think it was county water out there,
yeah,
wasn't
it
at the time? Yeah. Now it's not. I don't think that it was then. It was very pure water, very good.
People don't realize how much water they go through.
Isn't that the truth?
See, I mean, when you look at like your water bill, because I see this in St. Mary's, because we, you know, bill for water. You know, average person uses about 100 gallons of water a day. They don't realize it. You know, and as far as, you know, going without water, you can only live 3 days without water. So it's very, very critical. You know, you know, if you don't have water coming into your house, you're gonna have got like probably 40 gallons in your water, you know, hot water heater. You know, you may want to think about the tank in your toilet. You know, that it's before it hits the bowl, so it's, you know, not as bad as what you might think. And even a thing like, you know, you open up a can of peas, you know, there's a lot of water in there too. Mm-hmm. So I mean, we do teach, you know, as many of these skills as we can.
Yeah, so even when there's not a disaster, it's a good idea to just keep water on hand.
Oh yes,
in case there is one.
Mm-hmm. Definitely so.
With the climate situation being what it is, and apparently perhaps on the horizon and not getting much better, there you have to realize that perhaps the types of events we've had in the last 6 or 7 months with flooding and I'm not quite sure what our winter is going to be yet. So far it's been mild, but this might happen with a little bit more frequency than it has in the past. I can remember back as a kid that we had a couple of bad snowstorms every winter. I lived in South St. Louis. And, you know, and that was about it. You had cold temperatures, but you didn't have the snowfalls that brought traffic to a halt for 6 or 7 hours until they could get out and plow the streets or anything.
And when we were kids, it didn't matter if it snowed. You just went anyway. Yeah. You went to school.
Well, that's true.
Because you walked.
Yeah.
And you went to school, and you just, your life just went on.
Yeah. City of St. Louis public schools, when I was a kid, did not close just because of snow. They did not close school, so there was no such things as snow days.
Snow days, right?
We never had snow days.
I remember walking to school in deep snow.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, and in this December, we had that 10 inches of rain. And we were lucky because the temperature was above freezing. Could you imagine what it would, what that would have done if it came down in the form of snow or in the form of ice? It could have been a lot worse.
Oh yeah, that ice storm a few years ago was horrible.
We went
down to Florida, I think either there or Gulf Shores we went to. While it was on, we left because that's when our vacation was. And all the way down, there was such devastation. Electric wires hanging right on the ground, poles laying over, ice on everything. I mean, the highways were clear, but the electric lines were just ice.
Oh,
the poles were ice, the fences were ice, the fields were ice. Everything was ice.
Mm-hmm.
I remember in Haiti, or Haiti, however you say it, their main source of power was just like that, about that far from the ground.
Yeah, it's very heavy.
No filling stations were open. We hardly could find gas. I mean, it was really sad.
Yeah.
All the way down, we were like, oh my God, this is awful.
You're lucky you made it down.
Well, the highways were clear. They had cleared off by that time. But you don't realize until you see things like that how bad things can really get.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
All the people without electricity, and it was so cold, and the ice, and no electricity all the way down. Everything was dark in the nighttime.
All the more reason to sign up for our training.
Yeah. Teach as many survival skills
as we can. It's time well spent. It doesn't cost you anything but that.
Right.
So it's fun too.
Oh yeah, it is.
It's very informative.
It is. I mean, we keep it light. You know, it's not real serious. So that's because we have excellent instructors. Mm-hmm. You know, we're very good at it.
Make sure I sign up on there.
Yep. I'm gonna see if I can get somebody signed up and go with me.
All right. Encourage that.
Because I think that would be interesting.
Yeah.
A need to know.
The lightning is still flashing when he uses that.
There we go.
When he uses that camera back there.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Is that what it is?
Isn't that what he said? The camera's not working right.
Yeah. Oh, is that what
it looks like? Lightning flashing on the screen when he uses that one. As long as he's on this one facing us, it's okay.
Oh,
when
good.
He faces
you guys, don't use the other camera.
Yeah. So you think you covered about everything, or you got more to say?
I think we have.
Hopefully enough to encourage people to seriously think about, and even if they don't take this class coming up within the next week or so, that's going to start next week or so, when we do offer another class, which we may at least once more, I'm sure, maybe twice during the course of this year. This year is just getting started. Please consider it.
I'll go find it and share it on Facebook.
Okay.
And tell everybody else to share it.
Yeah. That's how the word gets out nowadays.
Yes.
Yeah, it is. Isn't that the truth? Just waiting to win that lottery tonight. Everybody under the earth has got it.
Nobody in their right mind needs that much money.
No, but it...
They don't. There's no... All you're asking for is trouble. Because you can't let your kids... You're going to have so damn many friends that everybody's going to be
just start giving it away.
Yeah.
That's what all these places are doing. Yeah. There's so many on Facebook now that you just have to like them and share their posts and you get a share of the money. I bet I've got 20... Well, some of them's got 5 and 10 tickets. So I bet I got 100 chances to win if not.
Well, all right, well.
I clicked on all of them.
Well, they should probably have already drawn the numbers, so.
Yeah. Yeah, we do not teach the financial planning as part of this class.
So if you win the lottery, you're on your own.
Maybe we should for your own survival.
How much your chances are in winning that?
Yeah, I know, it's pretty slim.
Somebody will eventually.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure tonight, there's probably so many people around the country.
Oh, I imagine.
Oh, yeah.
Wasn't it last week, there was 75% of the possible numbers used?
Yeah.
I think that's what they said, something like that, 77%.
My husband buys them, and it's funny because he never gets a Powerball. And this time it was 13, and he got the damn Powerball. Nothing else but the Powerball.
Do you get a ticket for that?
You get $4.
Oh, you get $4.
So when you call in, what do you ask for? Just the...
Just mention, everybody who will answer the phone will know exactly what this is, you know. So just say, you know, I want to sign up for the CERT class.
Yeah.
CERT class?
Yes, sir.
More than likely, you'll end up talking to Mary Roth.
Yeah.
Probably, if she's there. You know.
Yeah, she shares my name.
Yeah.
Her name is Mary Ann Roth.
Yeah, yeah.
I went there to get a shot that day, and she said, I don't think people are going to believe this. I said, why? Because she said, I'm signing it up, your name's up here, and mine's down here saying that I'm the one that did it. they're going to believe this. I said, yeah, I know. I said, you know how many there is of us in this county and city? 5. I get so much screwed up mail and phone calls, it's not even funny. So I start writing my name a little bit different. That's what they suggested. I said, can I change my name? And oh my God, I thought that woman down Social Security office was going to have a fit. She said, do you know what we have to do that? She said, no, you don't want to do that. Just learn, just write it different. Just do something different. And she told me all things had to do, and I said, yeah, I guess that would be kind of hard to stick some of the name in the middle of there.
Just make up your name and go by alias.
You have any questions for us?
Yeah.
I think you did a good job with covering.
You guys did a good job.
Yes, very good.
Excellent. So anybody that wants to sign up, call out to the health department at 883-7411.
That is correct.
And tell them you want to do the CERT.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thank you. And we appreciate the opportunity to be here.
Indeed.
Well, anytime you want to come back, just call.
Yeah, anytime.
On any subject they have out there. And the girls know it because we've told them.
Well, they do a lot of programs out there. They're very beneficial.
Yeah, anytime you've got a program that you want to get out.
Yeah.
I think, does Sandra, does she announce that at the meetings when they have the community meetings, or she announces it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I told her.
Yeah, we had a community services forum meeting this morning, and she did discuss that in brief, but she did mention the fact that we have a class that's starting very soon, and in fact had a number of those flyers there, and didn't have any left, so hopefully.
Yeah, because she, I asked her if she would, well, in fact, Don put me on the list where I got the emails, so we could probably pick up some programs.
Mm-hmm.
And she sent a couple to us already.
Yeah, you guys did a good job.
Oh, thank you. We're passionate about it.
Yeah, very glad to have you. Any guest that wants to come on, we're always happy because that's what we started this for, is to inform people of what's going on in St. Genevieve.
Oh, yeah.
Because we thought it would be fun, which it is. It's a lot of fun. We have a good time with everybody that comes on.
Oh, it's popular.
And hopefully people watch us. I don't know.
They used to call in. Now I don't know.
Now Pat's not here. Pat was always calling us. And
Pat was
our friend, and she passed away. Yeah. So.
Oh, no.
Bless her heart.
If anybody wants to be our friend, just call us.
Just call us every night, every second, fourth Wednesday, and you can be our friend.
Right. We'll talk to you.
So who do we have coming
up? On our next show, we have Katie from the Extension office, and she doesn't know what she's going to talk about yet, but she'll find something before then.
Oh, yeah.
And then we also have Mickey and Allie about the King's Ball. And they are wonderful. So everybody, listen to Snag Me on the 27th, because they just are, I think they're so much fun.
Yeah, they love the King's Ball.
Yeah, and they love the King's Ball, and they
No, it's the Queen's Ball this year.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Well, I better put that in the paper.
It's the Queen's Ball.
Is it really?
Yeah.
It ain't leap year.
It's the Queen's Ball, because I read it in the paper.
Yeah, every so often they change it to the
I thought it was only leap year.
I think this is leap year.
Oh, is this your leap year?
Yeah, leap year when there's presidential elections.
Well,
I don't know one year from another. So we got the Queen's Ball. Now, Mickey didn't tell me that. Queen's Ball instead of the King's Ball.
Yeah, I knew I read it in the paper.
Yeah, and Katie is very, very, very knowledgeable about anything. So if anybody's out there wants to ask her question about growing things, about
planting
your ground,
anything, just planting. Give her a call.
Yes, at her office, or call her here when she's on next week. I mean, 2 weeks from now, the 27th, because she's very, very knowledgeable. And she loves her job.
Oh, yes.
You can tell by how she even, I even went in and asked her what a bug was one day, and she figured it out for me, yeah. Just told her what it looked like, and she found me a picture.
Well, sure glad you guys came on talked about
it. Glad to have the opportunity, so thank you.
This is great. I really think I should take this.
Then you can be the group leader.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
And write down all the information. That's what I'd have to do, is write all the information down.
Well, the leader's the one that does the least work, you see.
Oh, yeah. Is
so
that
that's
it?
Why, yeah. That's why it's, yeah.
That's...
You're just...
That's it.
Put that over there and lift that up. Yeah. You don't.
Yeah. Actually, you're just the boss lady.
Yeah.
That'd be neat.
Okay, so I guess good night, everyone out there.
Is
watching
he,
us.
Is he getting ready to cut us off?
He'll cut us off when we tell him to.
Okay. So you can cut us off.
Yeah, cut us off.
We'll say. Or